Welcome to ElectroLine. Now here we have a interesting and a very challenging problem for a JE main question. It deals with Coulomb's law and simple harmonic motion, so it's kind of put together, and that's what makes it a little bit more challenging. And let's read the problem together. It says two electrons each are fixed at a distance 2d, assumably apart from one another. A third charge, which is a proton, is placed at the midpoint and is displaced slightly by distance x, x being much, much smaller than d, perpendicular to the line joining the two fixed charges. The proton will then execute simple harmonic motion. I presume that you push it and then let it go. It'll go back and forth like that, having an angular frequency of one of those four choices, with m being the mass of the proton. Wow, where do we start with this? Well, the first thing to do is to draw some diagram that will help us understand what is happening. So we end up with two electrons. So here's one electron over here, another electron over there. They are connected to something so that they cannot move. So they're attached to something, so they're fixed in place. And they're a distance 2d apart from one another. So if I take the halfway point right there, so this would be distance d, this is distance d. Then a proton is placed at the halfway point and displaced a small amount of distance. So let's go ahead and put the proton over there. And let's say that this distance right here, we'll call it x. That's a small amount of displacement. And then if we let go, the proton would then go back and forth like this. All right. So if we think about simple harmonic motion, we talk about a restoring force. So what is the force that would be taking the proton and pushing it back to its equilibrium point? Of course, by the time it gets there, it's moving at some velocity. It will overshoot, go to the other side, stop, because at that point, the restoring force is slowing it down, then it's pushing it back to the equilibrium point, and that's how the proton will continue to go back and forth like that. So what is the restoring force here? Well, the restoring force will be the force of attraction between the proton and the electron in this direction, and the force of attraction between the proton and the electron in this direction. So we can say here at this point that the force, and it's the Coulomb force, so we have the Coulomb force F is equal to K times the product of the two charges. So if the charge here is Q and the charge there is Q, then the charge on the proton will be Q as well. Is the charge of a single electron, negative for the electrons, positive for the protons. So it would be the product of the two charges, Q squared, divided by the distance between them. Now, the distance between them. Okay, let's say that we have the angle theta here, and we can say that the sine of theta is equal to the opposite side over the hypotenuse. So that would be x over the hypotenuse. But since the angles we're dealing with are very small, because x is much, much smaller than d, at very small angles, we can say that the sine of theta would have to be approximately equal to the tangent of theta. And the tangent of theta, by definition, is equal to the opposite over the adjacent, would be x over d. So if the angle is small enough, then the hypotenuse would essentially be the same length as d. And I think we can make that assumption. So if that's the case, it's the distance squared, and that would be the force of attraction in that direction. Now, of course, there's two of them, one due to this electron and one due to that electron. So that's the force of just one electron. But then we're not just interested in this force, we're only interested in the restoring force, which pulls it back in this direction. That would be F in the y direction, so to speak. And then, of course, we have a component in the x direction, but we don't care about that one because that one will be negated by the fx in the other direction, so they cancel each other out, and only the two forces in the y direction due to the two electrons will be causing the restoring force. So if I would then say the force for one in the y direction, I then must also multiply that times, and notice that's the opposite of this, that would be equal to the sine of theta, to get this component right here. Of course, the sine of theta is the same as the tangent of theta, is the same as x over d. So that means that the force due to one charge in the y direction is equal to k times q squared over d squared times the sine of theta, which is the tangent of theta, which is x over d. And so that would be equal to d cubed in the denominator. And then also notice that k is equal to 1 over 4 pi epsilon sub naught. So that gives us q squared times x divided by d cubed, but also 4 pi epsilon sub naught times d cubed. And sometimes I write it like that, sometimes I write it like that. So epsilon sub naught. Okay, that's the restoring force. But notice there's two of them, so two times the force due to one, that would be equal to twice that. And so two divided by four, that would make this into a two, so we end up with q squared x over two pi, I forgot my pi, pi epsilon sub naught times d cubed. I always keep changing the way I write my epsilon sub naught, so there we go. All right. Now, that's the restoring force. Now we have to think about simple harmonic motion. And when we think about simple harmonic motion with a spring, notice if we have something that looks like this, with a mass and a spring, like that, and the spring would have spring constant K, then we know that the restoring force is equal to, let's see here, F equals minus K times X. And then we know that omega, the angle of frequency, is equal to the square root of k over m. So what that means is, if this is the restoring force for a situation like this, some constant times x, and omega is that constant over m, notice when we look at this here, the restoring force is this, which can now be written as q squared divided by 2 pi epsilon sub naught times d cubed times x. And notice that my constant k is the same as what's inside the parentheses here. And we still have x, which is a displacement from the equilibrium point as it goes up and down. X is, of course, a variable as it goes up and down. Which means that my k in here is equal to this quantity right here, divided, and then I have to divide by m. So that means omega is equal to the square root of, we have q squared divided by 2 pi epsilon sub naught times d cubed, and we can't forget about the m right here, and notice that is my angle of frequency of my particular situation there. Now, which of the four answers matches this? And it looks like is the one on top, A. A is the answer. This one matches exactly what I have over here, and that is how it's done.